Right, Aki Kareem, BBTV.
I do a look first.
You look great.
Does my nose look good?
Your nose looks fine, mate.
Looking good, yeah.
I haven't been asked that from a fighter for a long time. I'm here with unbeaten Raza Hamza. 15-0 now. You're going along a good pace there, man.
Not at a good pace, but...
Go on,
it's in the right direction, but not in a good pace.
When you say not a good pace, what do you mean?
Career's been stale. I mean, I've always been ready. I've always been training. I've been around world-class athletes. I've been around top sparring partners, top people. But my career's been stale. I've been kept inactive, basically. So, I mean, we're moving in the right direction, but it weren't at the pace I expected it to be. By now, I expected to have a few titles around my waist.
Does that make you a more ruthless fighter when you're sparring and training? Does it give you added focus? Does it? How, what do you mean? Do you feel frustrated? What's the?
Well, going back to being ruthless and more focused. I've always been a focused lad because I've had so much to fight for. You know, the losses I've had in my life, and then losing my brother too. I've always been a very focused and very determined lad. All I ever needed was a challenge. You know, when I get a challenge, I rise up to it. I know I would, but you know, it comes to a stage beating journeymen. You know, 20% of me can beat a journeyman. Not being disrespectful, but I know how good I am. But I've always been ruthless in training. I've always been a hard trainer. Sparring, I don't spar to knock people out. I spar because I've been around so many. I've been around Inui. I've been around Yafai, and I see what they do in sparring. And sparring is all about learning, practicing. You know, if I can spar you for 8 rounds and I don't get hit, that's good for me. And that's how I learn. I go to spars practicing my jab. And I love it when they're trying to press it and force it and try to take me out because it makes it easier for me. So yeah, sparring's always been about learning for me. But other than that, I'm always in the gym. I'm always training. I've always got the same mentality. Fight date or not a fight date, I'm in the gym at least 3-4 times a week.
Why have you been inactive then?
You know, like, there's so many reasons, you know. I had a small injury last year. Let's not go too deep into that because it's better. Not many people knew about it. Anyways, I come back from that. I was with MTK. Things never worked out. Then I was meant to fight just before the COVID. A week after we went into lockdown, it was meant to be my fight. That didn't happen. So this year is kind of 10 months, but then before that, I was kept inactive because I'm a fighter that I'm a high risk, less reward fight. If you're a champion or you're in the top 10, you won't want to fight me because you know it's a high risk and it's a less reward. And everybody, like, never mind on paper, but everybody knows me against any of them top 10 fighters in the country, it's a problem because they know I am a fucking good fighter. I am a good fighter on my day. I'm one of the biggest featherweights you see, and I'm a problem. But they know, taking the fight against me, and they get beat, where do they go? Where do they go? Because these guys are talking about this level and that level. So I have to, basically, I mean, whenever I've had an opportunity, well, I've not had no opportunities, but whenever they've come, it's been a week's notice. Week and a half notice, and I'm not stupid to take a week's notice for stupidness. Do you know what I mean? So I've waited. I was training in Birmingham, and now I'm back here with the room.
Yeah, when you say back here, for people who don't know, obviously we're at Northside at the minute. So you're training at Haroon Headley, and also just being around this gym today, you know, there's a very good vibe in the gym. There's lots of good fighters as well, isn't there? And you can bounce off each other. I know you're on your own path, though. Don't get me wrong, but. You know, why does it work for you? Why does this environment work for you?
See, now we've not got a fixed date yet. When it's a fixed date, you'll be one-on-one and you focus. But this is brilliant because you've got young kids in the gym. You've got young, fast 15, 16-year-olds who are keeping you going. And being in a good environment's good because everybody bounces off each other and you've got some good fighters in there. You know, it's just good. And me being in Birmingham is not good for me. For my boxing, because I've got so many distractions, you know. I've got friends, I've got family, I've got associates. After training, let's do this, let's do that. In Manchester, I get here on a Monday. I get here on a Monday. I get here on a Monday, And I'm in a hotel. I'm training, I'm sleeping, I'm eating, that's all I'm doing. And I'm going home on a Thursday or a Friday. So I'm getting all my work done and I'm going home, and that's my whole focus for the whole week, do you know what I mean? It's just boxing. When I go home, I can chill out with my friends and my family.
Do you think then it's important for, well, you specifically, you know, to just get up, get away and isolate, you know, why is that so important for you, you know, particularly?
I mean, with boxing, you can't be 50% in and 50% out. You can't be training in the day, hanging, dusting around all day with your friends, going to sleep late and then being tired for training the next day. This is an unforgiving sport, you know what I mean? Like, you see what happens, you can potentially die in that ring. So you want to give yourself, I mean, this goes out to every kid, you want to give yourself every percent possible to be the best you can be. And me being here, I mean, most fighters do it, most world-class top fighters get away from home, isolate, because it gives you that extra drive, you're resting right, you're eating right, you're training right, and you're not doing anything but training.
Now, you've mentioned that, you know, there's no specific fight date, but there may be something on the horizon.
Yeah, I've been told November the 28th or December the 5th, I'm fighting for a title. This ain't personal to anybody, this is business, you know. Isaac Lowe, I've been calling it Isaac Lowe, who's had 23 fights, he's won. Most of them probably drew one, never lost. Why are we in this sport? I'm in this sport to test myself. Yeah. I don't want to fight journeymen. I want to fight top fighters who have got titles. You know, I want to see how good I am, if I'm good enough, because I've been a pro for 5 years. And, you know, with a few things that have happened, few pullouts, that's all behind us. But now, I'm strictly about fighting for titles. I want to fight for titles. I want to see how good I am. I want to show people how good I am. Forget this hype. I want to fight, man. And there's the guy I've been calling out. I've called him out for over a year. I was told not to call him out, and now I've called him out. But he's, you know, he's saying it's a high risk, less reward fight. What does he get out of beating me? Which he's probably right about. But I know I can beat him. 150%, and I beat him twice on a Sunday morning and night.
Is that this type of fight that will get you into the zone where you think we'll see the best of you? Do you know what I mean? Do you need to have that type of fight now, where it's a name that everybody knows, a good fighter, and there's a little bit of edge, a little bit of pressure on it as well?
Absolutely, because I know he's a fighting man. I know he's a good fighter. And on top, look who's backing him. He's got Fury backing him, one of the biggest, best fighters in the world. So everybody knows him because he fights on the Fury undercards. So me beating him takes my level to work. What would you say when I beat him? What happens? What level am I then?
Well, the winner of that fight is in line for potentially even world title.
What level am I then? So I'm willing to risk it all. Okay, I've fought nobody in 15 fights, but you know, and I know, if I'm good enough. I am good enough. I've fucking been a world class amateur. I believe as a world class amateur. I've sparred the pound for pound greats. I'm a fit lad, and I know I don't need to. I forget British level, forget area level. If his fringe world level, I will beat him. And then what level does that put me in? And I know I'll beat him. Give me 4 weeks and I'll beat him, because I know I can.
Tell me more about you. You mentioned sparring with pound for pound greats. You had that. You went out to Japan, and you know, on your own, to spar Inoue in his camp. And they have the very different training methods there, the short sessions, you were telling me.
Yeah, absolutely, aren't they?
Tell me about that experience, because a lot of people just brush over that experience, really. But that is, you know, this guy's a monster anyway, he's a monster. You hung in there with him as well, and you got better as well, didn't you, with time? Tell us about it.
I had hype around me because I was meant to fight Louis Petit 3 times.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
3 times in 18 months he pulled out, which fucked my career, basically. I was 24, 25, I'm 27 now, I'm that old. But they go in there, the way they trained, the way we sparred, and I got better and better and better. Not many people would believe this, you know what I mean? Because it's the monster, it's one of the pound for pound greats. But listen, man, Lee Wood was there, Lee Wood,
yeah,
and the last few spars, it was like, what's going on, you know what I mean? But I learned so much from going out there. Being around him made me learn so much about how to approach training. about how to train for a 12 round fight, about how to, I mean, it's a pound for pound, great, how to train for a certain fighter. It was amazing the way they trained, and I took so much of it. But then after that, let's not forget, I was training with Kalia Fai for 18 months, who went and fought Roman Gonzalez,
yeah.
Who is another great, he was a great world champion and will become two-weight world champion. So me being around these world champions, early on in my career, I was sparring with Stuart Hall on a regular.
Yeah, former world champion.
Yeah, so I've been around world champions my whole career, sparring them, mixing in with them, doing really well against them. But, I mean, over the last 5 years, I've learned so much about professional boxing, how to approach a fight, how to train for a 12-round fight, and what these guys do different. And listen, I've never seen them get tired in a fight, so they must be doing something right.
You do seem extremely focused at the minute in terms of proving yourself, wanting to prove yourself. Why is it so important for you to prove yourself?
Well, first of all, extremely focused at the minute. I'm living alone here. I'm living here, training, sleeping, eating, getting up at 6 a.m. and training with the Rune.
Mm.
It's not about me proving to anybody else, it's about proving to myself how good I am. Because I've always been in the shadows of other people, you know, I've always been on other coming up behind other people, but now I want to show people that we're not people, I want to show myself, I want to show my loved ones, listen, I can do it for you. And you know, I've got a family, I look after my family, feed my family, and this is how I want to do it. I've done since I've been 11 years old, I've never worked a day in my life, and I've trained twice a day. So I mean, if it's boxing or nothing for me. So now you tell me I have to do well in it, do you know what I mean? I can't lose, I can't afford it.
Well, it does sound like you've got something on the horizon now. We won't obviously say just yet, but just in general, have you got a message for featherweight fighters then?
First of all, you know this fight I've got on the horizon, mm-hmm. which is not low, because they didn't take it. Well, he's got bigger fish to fry. This fight is harder than the low fight. I swear to God, this fight is harder than him. Do you agree to that? You know who it is.
I think it's a... I would honestly say it's an equally as difficult fight.
I think it's harder.
Right.
He's your mate, that's why you're saying that.
Everyone's my mate.
He's your mate.
Everyone's my mate.
But featherweights, listen man, if you've got something that I like, I've said this a few times, if you've got something I like and I'm getting the opportunity, I'm coming to have a go and take it off you. Because I'm working so hard, I believe in myself. And yeah, you won't out-jab me, you won't out-box me, so how are you going to beat me? That's as simple as it is. How are you going to get past my jab? Get past my jab, you got something else waiting for you. Get past that, you got a left hook pivoter waiting for you.
Fair enough. Yeah, I've watched you on the pads there, you're looking ferocious.
It's my day off.
This is your day off?
It's my day off.
Oh, you was looking good on your day off.
I just come to...
to see me.
Come to see you and Haru and go just do a bit. But I've been training hard, I did 12 rounds in the bar bag yesterday.
Yeah.
Which is hard. Sparred 8 rounds on Monday, did 2 sessions on Tuesday. Today's my day off. I couldn't walk when I woke up. Couldn't walk, but Harun goes, come on, let's get at least 45 minutes in. But I'm going home today, so.
Yeah.
I go, yeah, man, you're coming in, so. I couldn't move my legs, so. It was good, man, I really enjoyed it.
Well, I appreciate you coming out, you know, to see me anyway, because it's good to see you. You know, we'll go back, you know, years now.
5 years.
Yeah, and it's nice to see you with this renewed focus, and it's nice to see that. And I hope you do get a big fight, whether it's Isaac Lowe or whoever it is. And I do love that fight. And yeah, Isaac is my mate.
As a fan,
I would
be honest, who do you pick? That might
be. Who do I pick?
Yeah, who do you pick?
Ooh, that's putting me on the spot there. That's a good.
So you're a boxing man, right?
Yeah.
You know boxing.
Okay, so with Isaac, he's a real pressure fighter.
He's an experienced fighter.
So your chance is to walk him onto a shot. Okay.
Not even that, I'll walk to him with my jab.
Fair enough.
But see, my point is, you're a boxing man.
Mm.
Be honest, who do you pick? You don't know, right?
It's hard to pick that fight.
But I've not fought no one.
It's hard to pick that.
I've not fought no one. I've only done an 8 round.
Going into that fight, Isaac would be the favourite.
Why would he be the favourite? Because he shades an experience.
I think it's experience, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But boxing ability, talent, skill, fitness, I match him with everything. I match him with, he fades after 6 rounds, I won't.
And I think that's why I love the sound of the fight.
Do you know what I mean?
I do agree.
And you know boxing.
Yeah, never
mind paper. This is a good fight. And trust me, people would love to see this fight. So you know what I'm going to do? Isaac goes, go and win a title. I'm going to win a title. I'm going to win a title. I'm going to come back and sit in the same spot. You can interview me again. And I'm going to say, Isaac, I've won a title. Let's give it to everyone now. Let's have this fight. I made the best man win. And whoever wins goes on to world honours or whatever you want to call it. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. You know boxing, so you're not going to say anything because you're his mate, but you know what I mean?
Well, no one gives two fucks what I think.
That's yeah, that's no one does, but you're a nice guy, though. You're everyone's friend.
But you know, being a nice guy, that's not a bad thing.
Gets you far in life.
Well, being a nice guy gets you far when you when you're a professional boxer, you can be whatever you want to be. When you're a professional interviewer, you've got to be respectful.
Absolutely, but listen, he's saying he's got a fight December the 5th. He fights on Fury's undercards. Every fight Fury has, Isaac fights. And so let's see the opponent they have on that. Because they're looking at world level, so I'm hoping he's fighting somebody in the top 10 or somebody who's incredibly good. Not a Mexican window cleaner with 115 last state being stopped 5 times. It's true though, it's looking laughing.
Yeah, I'm laughing because of your analogy, yeah.
But yeah, man, best of luck to you. And I'll see you soon, Isaac. I'll see you very soon.